Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're now about to spearhead a new panel discussion. And we're just going to take a minute to set the stage.
So in terms of introductions, Pops is my old partner in crime. He has had the significant displeasure of working with me 30 years ago. Monica has had the significant displeasure of working with me 15 years ago. And these two guys are lucky that we've never worked together before. You'll get an option. Parry, come, guys. You heard Parry from Twitter. Amar Antarayan is from Bharti AXA. Monica runs HBO in South Asia. Pops did something unthinkable. He left the safe vestiges of advertising to go and do something in digital called Sapient Nitro. Well, good, actually. We have more chairs than people. I may have, Pops, I'm not that big yet. So I understand we're running short of time, so what I'd like to do is just start with a, I know I did the one-line introduction, but it probably didn't do you justice. So if you can quickly do a round of who you are and what you want them to know about you. We'll start with you, Pops.
Hello. It's working, yeah. It's working.
You're all wired.
Yeah, we're all wired.
Oh, you're all wired.
Yeah, since Mahesh is out to put all the traditional advertisers and advertising agencies out of business, I really outsmarted him because I just left a traditional agency and joined a digital company. Now I work for Sapient Nitro as Chief Creative Officer, trying to bring technology and creativity together. So that's my endeavor, trying to learn every day in this new world.
Monica.
Hi, can you hear me? It's on? Is it on?
Yeah.
Now is it? Okay. Hello, everybody. I'm Monica Tata. I head up the South Asia operations for HBO. I'm a traditional media person. Been part of the traditional media for last 25 years. He has been my colleague, and now he seems to be biting what actually the hand that fed him. Yes, I do completely agree, and which is why I've agreed to be part of this panel, because digital is the future. It's actually not the future, it is the present. And very strongly believe in the need to be connected to the consumer on 24/7, who's a 24/7 consumer, and how you need to keep connected. But I've been with HBO for about a year and a half now, and trying to do some monopolistic initiatives. We'll talk about that later.
Amar?
I think we heard a lot about a lot of things and brand and products, etc. I think the only thing differentiated or standing out from a lot of you in the room and me is that we actually are in the insurance business, where we sell no products but just sell trust. And the product we sell
is death, right?
Huh?
You're going to die.
Not necessarily. Okay. You could die, you could get disabled, you could get into have a heart attack, you could get cancer.
You're the bearer of good news.
So basically we are trying to sell a push product as opposed to the pull product like what we discussed, that all of you talked about. And it's a completely different ball game, be it on what you communicate, how you market, how you use media. Maybe I can throw some lights as we go along, and digital especially.
Barry?
I guess I'll need to keep my intro within 140 characters. So my name is Parry Singh. I run Twitter's business for Southeast Asia, India, Middle East, and North Africa. Follow me at Parry Singh.
Follow me at Parry Singh. That's nice. I want to really start by, we're talking about the 24/7 consumer. Pops, I mean, how has this affected the life at your company, at your clients? What are the signs, some interesting stuff and some stories about this 24/7 consumer? Is it mythical? Is it real? And how is it changing things today?
Yeah, it is for real, you know, the traditional marketing. When we all started marketing, it was the buying cycle. You know, you create different things, and then you look at an ad, you can't buy it, you have to wait for till next day morning, and then you walk out, and then you need some impellers on the way to the mom and pop store, and then, you know, finally you buy. Today, world has changed completely. You know, you sit in a sofa at Kroma, looking at a plasma TV, and you actually enjoy the hospitality of Kroma. While watching that, you are actually checking out the price offerings on that television set. and you find wherever it is cheaper, and then you buy it online on your mobile phone, and then finish the tea or the soft drink which Croma has offered you, and say Tata, bye-bye, and then get out of that place. But so world has changed, you know, the entire buying pattern has changed, that the way people are connected has changed. Couple of months back, Nitin Paranjpai said that 99% of the people do not trust advertising, they don't believe what you say. So if people don't believe what manufacturers are saying, whom do they believe? They only believe other people. So the trust factor has changed, everything has changed, you know, they people like to know what others are doing. They don't want the brand stories, they want their own stories. So the entire world has changed to an extent in terms of, you know, marketing and communication. Nobody wants to listen to a brand story because they know that brand stories are fake. So they want to listen to their own stories. And now brands are trying to understand, how do I tell your own story? How do I involve you in the story? So the entire landscape is changing quite dramatically because people have the power, they are willing to live without their wallet, but they're not willing to live without their cell phone. If the phone is not there, you are not there at all. This is a world which is always on, you know, 24/7, and then you don't know at the entire purchase cycle, where do they get in and where do they get out, and then how can brands actually try and then influence and then fit into that world.
Actually, you'd be surprised. I went to Croma to buy one of these large screen TVs the other day, and I went online, and the product was some 14% lower online. I showed it to the manager, said, I can't buy it. He said, I'll give you 15%. He actually matched and beat the online price on Croma. So maybe they're learning how to cope by just discounting madly. What's changing in your world, Monica? I mean, I remember when all of us were in television, we had this entire idea that, you know, 7 to 10 is a prime time period, and, you know, weekend there's daytime prime. Has this 24/7 thing changed programming? Has the second TV set come? How is 24/7 customer, if at all, changing your life, your operations and your work?
Completely, actually. So to give you perspective, HBO has been around in India for over 13 odd years, and it was an ad-supported service and continues to be one of our propositions in the country. And that was only to be done because actually HBO broke its DNA to launch an ad-supported service in India, because you would know globally it's a completely paid service. There's no breaks and there's no advertising. But the lay of the land was such that we didn't have another alternative. Post-digitization and post the evolution of technology, we were able to launch a premium service, which has been a real big success for us over the last year or so now. And we have two ad-free propositions called HBO Defined and HBO Hits, which are really popular amongst definitely the digital natives. And what we've seen is that the usage of digital as a medium has been such a fantastic connection with our consumer, because that's the audience. Our core audience is between 15 to 44, and the 15 to 30 year olds are the ones who are taking decisions on paying additional for content which they want to watch without any advertising. So what it's done to us is that now for us, traditional mediums actually are not our priority when we're taking certain marketing decisions.
Really interesting that a television channel should
it's
say that.
It's doing that, yeah. So it's like you said, you know, while it's a monopolistic situation, environment we are in currently, because we are the only players in the country today to offer this service, which is 100% ad-free, but it's not going to be long before somebody else does it. So how do you keep innovating and how do you keep adding? And that's where I do believe technology and digital world plays a big role. So for example, our HBO On Demand service, which is a very sought-after service on, unfortunately, only on one platform currently, which is Tata Sky, because that's a platform which is very digitally evolved and is always innovating and trying to do things. And HBO On Demand is one of the most sought-after service on their OTT service, on especially the SVOD service, which is subscriber video on demand for people who might not know. But that show like Game of Thrones, right? It has been the most successful downloadable show for them, which has beat even the Hindi general entertainment shows which are on the VOD service. So, I mean, these are examples which are out there. The reality is that the audiences are moving to digital mediums. And when I say digital, it's not just, it's within the linear platform also you have evolved, you know, the VOD service, for example. So, we are constantly looking at mediums. I mean, Twitter, for example, is a key platform which we use to drive our communication. Facebook and social media is huge for us. Mobile marketing, I think that's a fantastic ROI for, you know, our proposition, and where we can even do geo-targeting, you know, and you really focus, this is the area which is affluent and would focus on, you know, the customer base which I want to talk to, and I just talk to them, I can, you know, skip all the riffraff because that's complete waste for me. So the proposition demands that I use a digital mediums, and I do that very strongly and very successfully.
It's really interesting. I mean, this is really bringing to home the fact that digital is no longer mobile phone and and computer screen. It is a TV screen. And soon newspapers which come on tablets, that's also digital. Yeah. Amar, how is the 24/7 customer, is this fictional? Is it a fallacy? Is he or she real, and how is he or she impacting your life?
See, I think I'm going to talk about it very differently. I'm not talking about marketing. I'm not talking about selling. I'm going to talk purely on servicing. I'll just give you a recent example of how this 24/7 is proving helpful to us and our customers. Right? We had the JNK floods. Right? Because we are 24/7 and we have a chat thing on our website, etc., we were able to register and pay 150 claims. Guess what it has done for our branding in JNK? We've come across as a company who will be there when people need it the most. Telangana, when we had file-in, right? We emailed, called our customers, and said, this is what you can do to register a claim online. And this was, and you know, industrial claims are huge. They're crores and crores of money, right? But we said online registration, and we paid on-account payment well ahead of the settlement of the entire claim. So 24/7, especially in a situations that's happened in JNK. Fortunately, you know, we haven't covered much of AP and Orissa, so not too many claims coming from Hudhud. Really impacts the way we can answer and get back to the customers in a form, in a speed, in a manner that they really are able to relate to us, and we are able to build trust. Another example was on health insurance, right? What we are looking at is a lot of people need counseling. Can we have an online counselor 24/7 that our customers can come and get counseled by? Absolutely. Will that increase my revenue? No. Will it increase the trust that people have with us? Will that word of mouth happen about Bharti AXA? I'm 100% sure. So I think I'm going to, so how 24/7 is changing us, okay, on this, you know, marketing space, selling space, Yashali, and I think you are the experts rather than me talking about how to use the digital space for marketing and selling, but 24/7 from a servicing aspect is really, really driving big change for us, for our customers, and we need to stay on top of it. Right? Sooner or later, we're gonna have apps where you take the picture of your car or your two-wheeler, you email it to the insurance company and your claim gets settled. And the claim will get settled over NEFT. So there's no physical interaction period. And this will happen in a matter of minutes. Because we will be 24/7. Our underwriters, our claim settlement people, our claim adjusters will be online 24/7. The moment you send a claim request, it's going to get settled. Think of the change that will happen from a customer perspective and the nimbleness and the alertness we have to show at our end to make this happen. And if we are doing it, someone said competition catches very quickly, Vodafone lady or whoever it was. Yeah, right there, right? Okay. If we do it, none of this prevents competition from copying it tomorrow. So what next for us? If not anything, to me, more than digital, more than 24/7, it's really staying on top of the game, staying ahead of the competition, and call it digital, call it internet, call it mobile, call it whatever else, is just a way or tool of staying ahead of the game.
Perry, I mean, Twitter is 24/7. It's. I wouldn't ask you a basic question, but I'd love to see. I know you are in quiet period, so you can't really give numbers and stuff. But I wonder if you can just tell us stuff like, of the people that come on Twitter from India, you know, what share are awake outside of prime time? I mean, do you have like, how many people are up there at 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning, or what percentage of the audience? What does the Indian scene look like? I mean, is it still everything spiking around 7 to 10 p.m.? What does the 24/7 scene on India look like on across 24 hours and across the 7 days? I'm just curious if you can share that. That can't be strategic.
Sure, no. No, in fact, it's a very timely, it's interesting you ask it today because just in the morning I was with one of our large clients. It's a CPG company. And, you know, we were going through some trends for them. And we, you know, they were interested in understanding how the food conversation trends on Twitter. They had a particular interest in food. So it turned out that, you know, Monday lunches is when the food conversations absolutely peak. They come down a little Tuesday. Wednesday, again, it spikes. Thursday and Friday, people don't even think about food. It just drops. And week after week after week. And then Saturday night, the food conversations spike again. And we saw this pattern repeated week after week after week. It's very interesting. In the last, you know, every March, they were interested in one more category, which is beauty and fashion. Somehow, every March, there's a big, we've seen this for the last 2 years, the interest in beauty and fashion just spikes. You know, so there are some interesting trends coming up which show that it's not a off prime time medium. People are using this medium to voice out whatever they're doing on a day-to-day basis. It's an everyday medium. People are talking about traffic. You know, so the word traffic actually peaks from 7 to 9:30. It peaks every day and again in the evening. So I think it's an everyday medium or, you know, all the time medium. People, it's just a reflection of what's going on in people's lives. And whatever's happening in people's life, the emotional fulfillment of it happens online. It's a very interesting point. I mean, the trigger is offline. You go to a restaurant, you like something or you don't like something. You go to watch a movie. I'll give you my own example. I checked into a hotel, and I will not name the hotel. But
I'll look at your timeline and figure it out.
Yeah, okay. I didn't name the hotel, but first they told me that there is no free Wi-Fi here, which I was a bit surprised. I'm like, no free Wi-Fi, really? And then I was told that when I went to the room, I didn't see a bedside charging point, which I'm very particular about because you need to charge your laptop and mobile and so on. So I tweeted about it, and I said that anybody who comes up with a blacklist of hotels, you know, that do not have free Wi-Fi or charging point, we'll be forever indebted to him, all the travelers. And that just took off. People started retweeting, and people started talking to me and saying, this is my biggest pain point, you know, not having a free charging point over here. So I think whatever happens in people's lives just gets reflected and voiced out on Twitter on a regular basis, no matter what they're doing.
So, I mean, my only theory on that food conversations dropping at Wednesdays, I think that's when the drink conversations start.
We should have checked that.
Yeah. The interesting thing about, I don't know about Twitter per se, but you know, we did this analysis, and then we figured out that the maximum traffic actually is during office hours. So I don't know what people do during office hours, and being a CEO and managing director, I get worried at times, but we have data. Given that our parent is Airtel, we can actually see traffic, who's doing what at what point in time. Traffic on the internet, be it whatever you want to call it, Google, Twitter, whatever else, is the highest during office hours, and there is a dip during lunch hour. So you can clearly see what people are doing in office.
During work, they're on the internet.
Yes.
And during lunchtime, they're eating.
I hope so.
Yeah. Because that's when the conversations go.
Yes.
So I think the only thing I can add to that that's interesting is one of the larger banks out there. And 3 years ago, 80% of the issues or complaints or whatever about the bank would be between 10 and 5, Monday to Friday. Mm-hmm. This year, 80% is outside of 10 and 5, Monday to Friday. People on their way home. And in fact, the head of marketing was complaining to me the other day. Look at this case. This guy tweets at 9 p.m. with a problem. Next morning at 7 p.m., he says, 7 a.m., he says, what the hell, the bank hasn't solved it. He says, what do you expect me to do
exactly
between 9 p.m. and 7 a.m.?
Exactly.
But according to that guy, he's giving you 10 hours to solve the problem.
Exactly.
Doesn't matter, it's 10 hours for the middle of the night.
Absolutely.
Right? So I do want to ask you, so this is where it is right now. Just, Monica, just put your eyes ahead 3, 4, 5 years ahead from now in India. What's the scene going to be? How is it going to be different? How is this 24/7 customer going to change the life. I do know that, you know, one of my investments is in agency, and as an agency, we work two shifts because our clients, you know, are getting talked about at 3 a.m. in the morning. So we have copywriters working shifts. I never thought I would see that happening in my lifetime, but it's happening. What are the changes that you see, say, 5 years from now, 3 years from now, in with all of this 24/7 always on happening?
Yeah, well, I guess, one, from a consumer point of view, there will be more screen consumption which will take place, because obviously the audiences are looking for not just one linear medium. Appointment television is going to only go down further. It is not about appointment television, wouldn't be so much, even if it exists still reasonably high, when especially with the Hindi general entertainment. But the mobile penetration, I do believe, will change that game, because we're talking markets which are not still connected from digital cable point of view, and yet there is high content consumption requirement and need and desires which are growing in that audiences in rural markets, where mobile penetration, I do believe, will take that audiences away, which means you might go into media dark sort of areas to straightway mobile lit areas. And that is a quantum shift, I would think, which will happen in the content consumption or the consumer consumption. And you also know the fact that there are markets, in especially north of India, where there is electricity, dearth of electricity, and there are no, for hours, there is no ability to watch television. And that's where mediums like these will sort of take on. So hence, with that, will come about a shift in the broadcaster's way of approaching that.
Not even a broadcaster. In some way, you're a multiple narrowcaster.
You are, actually. So it's how you drive your content. And that's where depends on whether you're creating content or acquiring content. That's where the game gets more murkier, because the rights will add to the complication and challenges. How do you really, because these are different kind of rights you need to deal with.
I have a question for you. I mean, so you're in the business of producing content. Interestingly, you know, I was meeting with somebody senior from Red Bull the other day, and they said they are a content company.
Yeah.
Because they produce all this content, which is about adrenaline and about... So do you see Red Bull as a media company competing with HBO?
Well, technically...
With Nike?
Yeah, they all are creating content. And I think it's not about competition, it's about coexistence. And I think there's a happy coexistence which will happen across from every media brand, whether it is companies like Red Bull who are becoming content companies, or Google and, you know, who are also claiming to be, you know, and media companies in that sense. So I think it's a happy coexistence. The challenge really will be for marketers, and how do you really talk to consumers who are so, so fragmented?
So the market has to decide, does he go and, you know, be part of HBO, or does he start his own channel?
I think that's a bit too premature to come to that assumption. But if you're giving a five-year window, I think that's really where the challenges will be to be worked on.
Kevi, so 2020 vision, your vision about 2020, neither of us is 2020 vision, but what happens 5-6 years from now? What's the change in India that you see?
I mean, not just India, you know, everywhere, the way people are connected, the way people are interacting with brands has changed completely. Earlier, there were only two worlds which existed for a brand. One was the physical world, you know, you buy a product, use, touch, feel. The other world was the emotional world, that's where the advertising, you know, created lots of brand empathy. Now brands exist in three different spheres. There is a physical world, there is an emotional world, and there is a virtual world. And then all that which we are talking about is the experiences which you have in the virtual world. You know, for instance, you take you know, an airline, correct? At one point in time, you know, the joy of flying was sitting in an aircraft, actually tasting beautiful cuisine and, you know, enjoying. And today, the pain points of booking a ticket, and that the prices at which people are selling you, there are a lot of other things which take away the joy of flying, because the brand and then the interaction with the brand is happening elsewhere, and then the thing. So to me, one of the biggest shifts which will happen and which is happening as we speak is a brand is equivalent to the experience. And there was a time when you used to make, I mean, call a product as a brand because of the emotional equity. People had through series of stories one has told them through television, today, if they're not viewing television, where is the source of that emotional bonding with the brand? There's absolutely no emotional bonding with the brand. So including, you know, his sector of insurance, where carefully for so many years, you know, one has created, you know, beautiful emotional connect with people. And then today the next generation is coming and then interacting, going to policy bazaar and then buying the cheapest instrument. So the point which I was making earlier is from brands, most of the brands are becoming, because of the digital medium and then the way the people are behaving today, they're becoming commodities again. You know, you look at airlines, they're commodities today. You know, you look at insurance sector, it's commodity today. So all the things, you know, which are becoming commodity. So the biggest challenge is the always on consumers. How do you create an emotional equity with them so that you become a brand again in their life? So that becomes the huge issue. So therefore, the series of experiences, you know, you mentioned that if you don't have a charger next to your bed, you know, that, I mean, that's an experience with the hotels. So it is, you know, listening and then creating a series of experiences for people so that they will, these experiences will equal into a little bit of emotional quotient. That's where, again, commodities will become brands.
That's interesting. So we're talking about experience design and to the point, Barry's point about, so there's a brewery that I'm an investor in and they're opening up in Bombay and they delayed for 2 weeks because in every, on every leg of every table there's a plug point and they were the wrong plug points, right? So they delayed the launch by a couple of weeks till they got the right plug points in the legs of the table. It's a brewery, so people can drink the beer and charge their phones at the same time. And I'll come to your other point where you know, where insurance is again becoming one where, you know, it's becoming less and less differentiated. But I want to come to the talking about experience and experience design and going a little forward. Barry, what's your picture again? You can say this safely during your quiet period. But India, 5 years from now, Twitter, wideness, where do you see this?
Yeah, I think a lot has been covered, but I'll say three things. One, I think the difference between offline and online is merging and will completely merge. You know, when we get to a stage where we are either sleeping or we are connected, there won't be any third stage. We'll either be sleeping or we'll be connected. Then what is offline, what is online, those differences will not only cease to exist, they will not matter. Because if you see a tweet on a billboard, what do you call it? You call it offline, online, those differences will not matter. I think that's one. The second is, you know, being connected all the time and having mediums like Twitter or Facebook on your mobile phone does something very interesting. It provides a voice to everyone in the country, everyone in the planet. And that changes the dynamics in a very transformative manner. What it does is brands that are able to channelize people's voice into co-creation of a product, of a service, of a brand, are the brands that will thrive. It's very important. And brands who are doing it in isolation will find it difficult because the collective intelligence that exists outside of a company is always more than what can exist within the company. It's always the case. You know, Amar talked about JK floods. I'll give you an example of these two phenomenons coming true in the context of JK flood. You know, one of the biggest relief initiatives in JK flood was this group formed by 8 guys. They formed a group called JK Flood Relief and they started a Twitter handle. They started off as an online group, just a simple Twitter handle. They realized that because there were no telephone lines working in Kashmir, that handle became the primary source of input for all the offline relief work. So everybody started. All of a sudden, these guys got thrust in the limelight of it. Everybody's depending on these guys to provide them information. Then a lot of corporates wanted to help and send relief material to Kashmir. They got in touch with these guys and they asked them, hey, can you help us? We have to send this relief material. Let us channelize through you guys. And all of the boundaries between what was being done on Twitter versus what was being done offline cease to matter, because where does one end and where does the other begin? I think that's important. And my third point is this. Brands will start realizing that there's a difference between doing social and being social. You know, right now, social is this one element, one department, which is part of a marketing department, set of 3 people just tweeting or putting Facebook posts, which is fine. But that's not being social. Being social is when everybody in the company embraces this medium, whether you're a CMO or a CFO or a CEO, understand what's going on, what's being talked about with respect to your company and your respective function, and do something about it. You do not need a title to have a voice these days for your company. Anybody can do it. That's the beauty of this medium. So offline online integration, co-creation, being social versus doing social. We think these are the three trends that are emerging.
I agree. I mean, I think there's a way to go. I was again sitting with, I think, the CMO of a very large chocolate company the other day, and he says, "Boss, we're going digital." So I said, "Okay, so tell me what are you doing?" He says, "We have this new gifting thing that pack we're putting together for Diwali." And I said, "What happens?" So if somebody buys it, there's a QR code, and somebody has to scan it, and then, you know, on the QR code we'll have pictures. I said, "I lost it." I said, "Some agency must have told you, or did they bother to tell you that nobody uses QR codes in India?" So he had a very small look on his face. You know, I think there's a long connect between doing social because we have to do something. There's a category in the advertising awards saying, "Boss, digital mein kuch karna hai, kuch kar do." How is 5 years from now? You know, Pops talked about the fact that you guys are, you know, and in very strange. My dad came up with this the other day. He's 80 years old, and he said, "You know, this guy was wanting to buy insurance for my car. He refused to come down in price. So I just went online and I paid off, you know, 20% less than him. And he came crying to me, sir, you know, why didn't you ask? I could have matched the price." So what's this pressure on price that's going to happen? That's because, and 5 years from now, you know, how is this going to change your life as a services brand?
Yeah, I think before that, you know, one comment. If you're either sleeping or connected, anyone who wants work-life balance in this room can forget it.
Okay. I believe you're going to be connected even when you're sleeping, because today's watch bands and bookies and all of that stuff, you know, yeah, are just going to measure that, oh, you're sleeping.
Yeah.
I need to wake you up now.
I got a Fitbit.
She's got a Fitbit, right?
Yeah.
my phone does the same thing. It kind of senses, am I moving around, am I awake and stuff.
Yeah.
Even that's going to go away.
So
you're going to be 24/7 connected even when you're sleeping.
The definition of what's work and what's life will change.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's all work and no play.
I'm sure there'll be a watch band which, you know, tweets in Morse code while you're sleeping into your skin or something.
Who knows? Probably all these will go, I'll just have a chip inside the skin. In terms of what's going to happen on the digital space and how it's going to alter the, you know, insurance industry, I think this is just the first step, which is the, you know, the price drop happening. And the reason for that is you don't pay commission to the intermediary. So that's why the price drop is happening. So it really doesn't make much of a difference. I think where the differentiation will come in products where advice is required, where advice is not required. Where advice is not required, price will be the key thing. And I think there'll be a bunch of vanilla products, and then there'll be, you know, key differentiated products for which advice may be required, which may, you know, require still offline. But if you look at what has happened, say, in the UK, et cetera, if you look at retail, say, example, motor or home, pretty much everything is online, either through an insurance company or an aggregator. So I think it's not far from happening in India.
So what share of your business comes through online right now, and what share do you see it go to 5 years from now?
So I think if you look at the online business, for most people, there are two pieces to. One is new business, one is existing renewals. So if you remove the renewals, which is actually new customer acquisition, it's less than 5% for most industry players. But I think the jump is going to be more to, from say less than 5% today to almost, you know, 30% in the next 5 years, at the very least. And again, where it's going to be come from is going back to her point on mobile, right? Most of the people in India don't have insurance because they don't have access to insurance. With the cell phones penetrating to the rural areas, there's only one change in the regulation required from the Telecom Regulatory Authority, which is allowing talk time to be used for payments of other services, or the telephone companies becoming small banks, or what they are calling for, you know, payment banks. I think M-Pesa is there, Airtel is, Airtel Money is there. Once that happens, then you really see an uptake of insurance from the smaller cities, villages, rural India, who will all get an opportunity just at the click of a phone button or touch whatever, to buy insurance, and more importantly, get their claims settled using the banking that mobile offers. So that's going to be a huge splurge. People who are ahead of the game will really benefit from it.
Great. So I think, I hope you guys have lots of questions for this extraordinarily wonderful panel of yours. So if you can just put your hands up. Sir, you're first, you're second. Any other hands? You're third. There's only one table that's decided to ask questions. What are the rest of you guys doing? Tweeting. Okay. Gentleman out there.
Hi, my name is Ranjan. I work for Pfizer. My first question to Perry, I'm okay with it for the 24/7, but my question to you is that when I'm in office, Twitter bothers me each and every moment whom I follow. Suppose I have a brand and I'm active in Twitter, I don't mind small window pops up and gives me feedback. but equally I get engaged to 100 other tweets. So it actually takes my working hours. So my question to you, how do you manage that? What is your comment?
So Parry, Twitter causes ADD. How are you going to stop people from getting attention deficit disorder? And that's a pharmaceutical guy asking you the question. Maybe there's a drug that we should develop against Twitter, huh?
And my second question, I'll finish it. My second question is that either Twitter or Facebook, it is, I mean, we need to live with it. And it is a habit. When I miss it in during my day, and midnight I woke up and I try to see that. So how do I balance this?
So it's affecting your love life. What's the question?
Yes, yes.
All right. So one, Twitter causes attention deficit disorder. Two, Twitter causes erectile disorder. Right? So defend yourself.
Okay. So I was not told
that I have to be a straight face through this.
I was not told I have to be a life counselor here. You know, I came here as a Twitter spokesperson. So I think each person, here's the thing, and I, without you know, trying to represent Twitter over here or the social media companies, I think all these companies, you know, we are in the early stages of most of these media. The important thing is, you know, man has always been social. It's the last 40 years that have been an aberration, by the way. In the last 40 years, we came to a stage where a few companies owned the license to broadcast, you know, television programming or radio programming. If you go back, step back, that was not how it was meant to be. You know, people would, you know, sit near campfires and exchange ideas. In 1700s, in England, there were coffee houses where people would meet on a regular basis, and each coffee house had a very specific theme to it. Some were about literature, some were about science, some were about philosophy, and that's where the great discoveries and great inventions came up. So we have always been social, it's not new. It's just that now we have a technology backing social. And if you felt that the last 40 years there was no social medium, that was an aberration. Actually, the norm is to be social. So that's one. I think some of these technologies are in the early stages of development, and because of which, even human beings, people, are trying to find the right balance. Balance in terms of, A, how much do I use? When do I use? And really, you know, how much do I need to respond to? Who do I need to follow? What is the right kind of timeline I need to have? I think that balance will evolve, and we'll understand. You know, if you go back all the way, again, I'll go back to history is always a good precursor to what's happened. If you go back a long way, and the first time when writing was introduced, Socrates, who, by the way, was not fond of writing, there's actually a quotation by Socrates which says, writing will spell the death and doom of deep thinking. Because true deep thinking happens through oratory, not through writing. And they were forecasters of doom at that time. Imagine writing, which is so fundamental. And so there was nothing. Socrates' dialogues were all oral, and Plato, who was his disciple, was the one who wrote them down. When printing press was introduced in 1500s, Gutenberg, there was a feeling that now this is end of quality literature, because anybody can print. Anybody has a, you know, who doesn't have quality controls can print. Now quality literature will be doomed. And there's written record for that. It didn't happen that way. I think we learned
but
find
the balance.
But we
still had Chetan Bhagat.
I love Chetan Bhagat. So I think we'll find the right balance. That's my answer
if
to your question.
I could just add here, and I think this has really been, it's a choice being given to consumers. Nobody's got a gun on your head to say that, you know, you have to be accessing your Facebook and Twitter accounts during office hours. I wonder your boss knows that.
Thank you, Monica.
But the reality is it's a choice, you know. You have the choice to switch it off during work hours and activate it when you're on the way back home. So, you know, it's completely, it's up to you how much you want to get absorbed or hooked and addicted to it, and how much work-life balance you want to make it happen out of these.
I don't think you can legislate it. I was working with one of India's, doing some work for one of India's largest IT companies, and they had apparently at that point a policy, they didn't allow their employees to use the internet during work hours. I thought that was crazy. So every employee had a smartphone, which they couldn't stop. I mean, what can you do? Legislate against a smartphone, they'll get a smartwatch. I don't think you can stop this. I think you've got to figure out a way to let this happen. Because what happens on the other side is you may not be that productive at work from 9 to 5, but you will do your work between 5 to 9 at home. So it works out in the end. As long as, I think increasingly, maybe we'll see the death of the 9 to 5, maybe we'll see the rise of the 4-hour workplace, who knows. As long as you now define roles and jobs not by the amount of hours you spend, but by the results or the outcomes you want, people will figure out they can do their work between 1 a.m. and 3 a.m. and that's fine. Now, I work 3 days a week. That's what I do in my own stuff, and I run two companies on that because I can't work more than that. But that, I have figured out in life. So I think more and more of that might happen. But we'll come to the second gentleman who had a question. Sir.
Yeah, Nishan from Piramal. And thanks a lot for the panelists to answer my first question. I had a two questions. The first, you have talked about discipline by the consumers, about the early generation of digital. Can you throw some light about discipline by the marketers in terms of what kind of discipline they should follow when they are thinking about putting their strategy for a social media? Because, and like whatever you are saying, a positive experience can build a loyalty. Similarly, negative experience can take away your entire equity. And probably the word of mouth power, which you have just talked about, Mahesh, will it impact them badly if a lot of service companies go with speed, not with the full information to the consumer, and they have a negative experience with them and they don't come back?
Maybe I'll take a shot at this. I think the first thing is to understand that people are talking about you at any point in time. You know, this bank that we worked with, it was talked about 7,000 times a day. Airtel is talked about 15 to 20,000 times a day by consumers, right? So you've got to always be listening. That's about your brand. Let's say you're in Piramals and you sold Abbott or whatever. You're in pharmaceuticals, you're in some of the business, real estate. There are people talking about you or your rivals. So you've got to have a method of tracking this. You know, have a dashboard or whatever else. Second, you've got to have a method of being able to deal with a negative right away before it gets out. You know, with one particular company, we helped them overcome a 10,000 crore drop in market cap in 2 hours because we figured there was somebody who was shorting the stock and doing it wrongly so, right? So you've got to have, please understand, a lot of this has investor IR kind of repercussions because there are people out there who will take advantage of social media to figure out something. They'll take a short position, create some false news, create a fall in stock price. So you've got to be really aware that at least between 9:15 and 3:45 or when the markets are open, you've got to be out there. So that's the third part is to analyze all of this stuff and say, so how are these consumers changing? Right? So we start with listening, then we start with solving a problem. The third part, I think, is analyzing. And then fourth is, out of that analysis, can you create a brief? Can you figure out and say, okay, fine, now the consumers seem to be concerned about this. Maybe consumers are, suddenly there's something happening on JNK floods, and maybe it's an opportunity for your brand to participate in a meaningful way. Maybe something happening with Hudud in Vishakhapatnam. Maybe there's something your brand can do in a meaningful way. Maybe, you know, Mary Kom won the gold. Maybe your brand can do something in a meaningful way. So finding out those opportunities, not just on the calendar that Parry talked about, which is predictable, but many of these are unpredictable calendars, potential triggers that you don't know that a storm is going to happen or somebody's going to win. After that, that brief provides an inspiration to produce something interesting. What can you produce? You produce another ice bucket challenge, something else that can spread by word of mouth, something else that can even go on television or print, whatever. What is your communication? Spread it out. Now, listen to the communication and start that cycle all over again. This thing works 24/7. So I would say that there is a process. It is not the 4 P's of marketing, right? I call it Aspire, which starts with absorb by listening, S for solve, P for plan, I for inspire, R for radiate, E for endlessly. You know, you follow this entire 6-step cycle. I think that's a reasonable discipline or a structure for you to follow, if that helps you.
So thank, which you have told me mostly, which will probably provide the brands to build a platform or engagement with the customer at the right moment. What I was trying to refer also to what the product strategy, which you have mentioned. A lot of times service companies are making product strategies, especially the example is Vodafone Red. A lot of good products have been made. I don't know what successful they have got, because many a times I have tried to do or understand the Red, but there is hardly any information which is concretely available on the net.
That's part of the strategy.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying.
I'm pulling a leg.
Many of the marketers I don't find. While you are talking about insurance, how much percentage of insurance till now is getting online?
We can take that question offline. Can I take the third gentleman out there? I think he's here. You're happy to answer his question offline.
Yeah, hi. I'm Abhijit, and we are a team from Piramal Healthcare, OTC division.
Like squeezing full value out of this conference. No?
Yeah, I hope you don't mind. Yeah, I think the last 1.5 hours have been quite interesting, starting from your session, Mahesh.
Thank you.
And from morning we have been discussing, and I think it's the flavor of the season now that digital in some way or the other is going to affect and is going ahead. But what I really wanted to pinpoint was that we have already, and as Parry right now pointed out also, it's more about the consumer. The consumer was disengaged till last 30 years, and he has now found a way to engage again, and that's how digital is getting stronger. But tomorrow, if the popular mediums, the television, the print, also figure out a way of a better way of engaging the consumer, then I think we would be more kind of having a better picture than the way we are trying to paint the digital picture right now. That's one. Secondly, how do we take care of the regulatory mechanisms? Because India is a country where suddenly we have a regulatory mechanism which comes about intrusion into privacy, and then the marketers have to think all over again. And so how do you account for that before you kind of draw that line? So any thoughts on that?
I can maybe add one thing and probably pass it on. I think on the regulatory mechanism, there's two approaches. One is check, 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 verify, 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 push to get a regulation. And the other approach which many Indian MNCs take is pretty much, you know, go ahead, do it, and then ask for forgiveness. And many companies do the second route. Kar do ya jo karna hai, uske baad galti hoge to maafi mang do, right? As opposed to sitting and saying, I don't have clarity, actually push for whatever it is. And also in terms of your product life cycles, the one thing, I was sitting with a large hardware company yesterday, and their point was that we really over-engineer our products, and increasingly I think you've got to be ready for your product to be in beta. It's hard to say that to a pharmaceutical company, can you have a drug that is in beta? That's okay. As long as it's good enough, I don't know what your regulatory issues are, but with a lot of products and services offerings, it's good, it's fine. Be in beta, then release a version 0.1, then 0.2, 0.3, and your product is never done. The idea of waiting for the perfect product for the great time, by the time I think you'll be kicked out of the market. So how can you figure out an incremental product schedule where you have what's called an MVP, you know, minimum viable offering. Just go out with that, go ahead, and as it gets adoption, keep improving the product. But let me turn the first part of your question over to, once the traditional media, maybe to you, once traditional media gets its act together, will all the social media go down again, which is essentially what he was asking?
No, like I said, it's a happy coexistence. Nothing's going to die, first of all, because when television came in, they said print will die. When digital came about, they said radio will die. Nobody has died, everyone's existing, and they will continue to exist. The usage of these mediums will continue to evolve, and that's where the new platforms, new mediums, whether it's social or digital or mobile, will have opportunities and choices given to consumer. And then it becomes very important for consumers to understand how to use these mediums. Not just because it's out there, I have to consume and get sucked into it, but that's a choice being given, and you would be spoiled for choice. And I think it's up to you how much you want to use that. So no one's going to die, really. It's going to be a happy coexistence of every medium.
Great. I think what we're doing is, I have these frantic calls from the sidelines saying, cut the session, so on and so forth. But what I can do is, you guys want to share your IDs so they can follow you and catch up with you later?
At sure. Parry Singh, P-A-R-R-Y-S-I-N-G-H. Happy to respond to you know, any questions, any comments. And I'm very active on Twitter. Surprise, surprise.
Yeah. at Doc underscore Amar.
At Doc underscore Amar. At Mahesh Murthy. I occasionally come on Twitter.
At mtata0503.
mtata0503. No, you know her birthday.
Right. KV Pops at Twitter.
The year is not known.
Yeah, yeah. It's 2005.
Absolutely. Sweet 16.
Yeah. Great, guys. Please put your hands together for this awesome kick-ass panel. Thank you, Pops. Thank you, Mona. Thanks, Parry. Thanks so much. Thank you, guys.
Thanks.
Great. Thanks.
Well, I'm going to request our panel members to please stay back for a group photograph. Okay. And may I also invite Mr. Vineet Bagaria, who's the sector head for TCL, to please come on.
We're going
to
get some of those really nice soaps and stuff.
I also request Mr. Vineet to please present the token of gratitude to our speakers.